You're listening to Brew with the Bennetts, which is now available on Patreon. Would you like an extra episode every week available to you on a Tuesday and also early access to the normal episode?
Keep going!
The normal episode, which comes out on a Sunday, you can access that on a Friday. This is all for the bargain price of £2 per month. If you would like to do this, then sign up now! Yes, sign up now! Sign up today! Welcome to the Brew Crew.
My coffee looks weird.
Well, there's not much milk, is there? Mm. Not very nice.
It's fine. Yeah. It's definitely decaf.
Definitely decaf.
Okay.
I mean, you don't need full... It's not full bar.
Yeah.
Mine's full bar.
Okay.
We've started, by the way.
Okay.
Tune in, it's Sunday morning. Sit back, relax, we'll talk it through. Brew with the Bennetts and you.
Should old acquaintance be forgot and never brought to mind? Should old acquaintance be forgot and the days of old lang syne? For auld lang syne, my dear, for auld lang syne, we'll drink a cup of kindness yet for the sake of auld lang syne.
What a bizarre...
Happy New Year, everybody!
What a weird song that is.
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year. What a weird song.
Well, if we want to hear the background of this... Which what I'm sure it? We quite, do. If we know the Brew Crew like we do, they love a little bit of background info. So Auld Lang Syne means times long past.
Right.
Auld Lang Syne. So Syne must mean time in some sort of old speak.
It's
and Lang, obviously long.
Yeah.
And old, A-U-L-D, old.
Or if you're in Nottingham, old. You're Auld Lang Syne, mate.
And... we've also got another bit of information here about the Auld Lang Syne.
Go on then.
For starters, the phrase Auld Lang Syne is Scots, the language spoken in Lowland
Scotland.
It's not
mine, I've never used it before in my life.
Not to be confused with Scottish Gaelic, which is spoken in the Highlands. And to translate it, old long since, but used more in the context of long, long ago. And of course, traditionally sang... On New Year's Eve. It's a poem written by Robert Burns in 1788, but based on an old Scottish folk song. In 1799, it was set to a traditional tune, which is obviously as we know it today.
As a kid, did you ever sort of stand there and wonder what the hell was going on when everyone
well,
did
I
that?
Well, I think I used to make it up. I didn't know the lyrics properly, so I think I used to go... Should old acquaintance be forgot and da da ba da? Should
your little
old
arms
acquaintance
going like the billy-o.
Be forgot for the sake of auld lang syne? Yeah. And yeah, I just used to make it up. Blah,
do
blah,
you remember
blah.
When we did that? When we were before we had kids, and we went round where you lived, and we did that sort of. It was millennium, and we went in people's houses.
No, what it was the millennium.
I've not dreamt that, have
I? It was a street party. That's what it was. We didn't just go round people's houses. It was an actual street party where people had their doors open.
Yeah.
Well, it was in the street. Yeah. I don't remember going in people's houses.
I remember going in someone's kitchen.
Well, it was probably the person that we knew.
And they said, why are you in my kitchen? And I was like, it's the millennium. I'm allowed in your kitchen.
Yeah. I remember that year you
that
loved a polo neck.
I did.
You loved a polo neck.
I didn't
neck
look
that
good.
Year.
I looked like a circumcised penis.
No, you look like the man from. You look like the man who delivers milk tray.
Not a good version. Yeah. I was at my heaviest that Christmas.
Oh.
It was the pasta and chicken year.
Was it? Was it the white dinner year?
It was the white dinner year. Mm. I come off the back of living in a flat with my own.
Was it pork chops, potato and pasta?
Yeah, and do you know what I thought? What would really accentuate the rolls in my neck
yeah.
is a roll neck.
Yeah.
And I thought, no, it didn't.
To be honest.
I look like sausages.
No, but you've just given me an idea. I really need to embrace a roll neck because I've got the port loin stripes across my neck.
Yeah.
And that would cover them up.
Yeah. You look like, do you know what I look like? Mm. On a good day, you look like a Cluedo piece. Do you know, like Colonel Mustard on a good day? On a bad day.
In a roll neck?
Yeah. On a bad day, you look like, like I said, like a circumcised penis.
I remember.
It's not good.
Back in the 90s, there was the sweater shop. Do you remember the sweater shop?
I do remember the sweater shop.
There was a massive trend to wear a sweater shop roll neck.
Yes.
With the sweatshirt over the top.
Too much wool.
Do you remember?
That was a lot of wool.
No, it was cotton.
Yes, I do remember.
So it was a cotton roll neck and then a cotton sweatshirt.
You looked like you were going to croon in front of a Christmas tree.
It was such a fashion. I remember
the sweater
the cool
shop.
Kids wearing it and I was thinking, I want to be in that gang. I want to wear the roll neck with the sweatshirt.
Do you know what? I've just had flashbacks now. The sweater shop. Where did it go?
Yeah. Oh, no. Where did it go?
I don't know. Maybe they were so blatant.
Where did it go?
Maybe they're so blatant in their advertising. They were like, the sweater shop is literally, we're running a sweatshop. And someone went, you can't do that, mate.
Was it the sweater shop or the sweatshop?
The sweater shop.
Yeah, not the sweatshop. Yeah, okay.
But I've not worn a roll neck since. And also, because I sometimes have eczema.
Yeah.
A roll neck is just...
Maybe a cotton one would be okay.
I don't know. I'm always conscious.
You wouldn't want Angora against your flakes, would you?
No. But it is a weird look. Are you right? It was a strong year.
For me and the roll neck.
Yeah, the roll neck was the 1999.
Yeah.
When Prince said, we're going to party like it's 1999, what he meant was, get your roll neck on. You know what was funny? Last night we watched World's Strongest Man. Did you watch it?
No.
Every year they do that. It's insane. Some of the men on there.
It's definitely a memory from childhood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What happens to the men afterwards? Because they are massive.
They're a bit like greyhounds. You know, when they've finished racing, they just get put down.
Out to seed.
Yeah, they just put them down.
There's just some massive. Come on. Tolskan, I don't know what the name is.
It's just like a terrible, they just get shipped off to farms.
Yeah.
And they just help carry hay bales.
In massive hangers.
And nobody loves them.
No.
People who visit, they just say, who's that out there? And they just say, oh, it was the World's Strongest Man 2010.
He's Icelandic.
Yeah, and nobody loves him anymore because he's no use, but he is still quite good at moving hay bales.
He moves hay and he can move a whole tractor on his back.
Yeah.
And every day. You should see the cost.
We just feed him 12 boiled eggs a day.
Yeah. You should see how much tuna he gets through, mate. He's a machine.
We have to make him use the outside toilet, though.
It did look like they were going to shit themselves at some points.
They probably did.
Do you know when they were carrying...
The poo part came out.
they move those... And some of the things, like one of them, they had to do deadlifts and the bar was bending.
Did you see that?
350 kilograms.
Did you see that year one of their biceps ripped open?
No. That's believable. Just popped out.
I'm joking.
Are you really?
Your face then, you were like,
because
no.
It's completely believable.
I know.
I always think as well, like, because they're wearing those tight pants with the belt.
Oh, that did happen.
And I always think.
That did. Do you remember that
little
year?
Hernia? Out the back.
No, do you remember when his arse came out?
No. You're lying again. I bet your arse does come out.
Oh, no. This is true. Right, this one is true.
No, it's not. I don't believe. I don't know what you're telling me
this
anymore.
This is true now.
Right, go on.
One year his dinkle dropped off.
You liar. Big dinkle. Big Icelandic dinkle.
Oh, God, that's so
just
funny.
Like a roll mop herring. Just... onto the ground.
Oh, God.
Do you know what, though? You see, he was doing the Atlas stones. You know when they
Why
carry
are they
those?
Why called an Atlas
stone? It's because it's the Greek sort of strength.
Atlas.
Yeah.
Like a ball.
I think it's the place Atlas or something. But he carried it. Mm. And he sort of, they go. They do that little walk.
Yeah.
And they go. And you can hear the commentator going, he's showing incredible strength here. Going for the big stones. If you've got if you lose the momentum, you're done. And
do you know what,
there was sweat coming over their eyelids.
Yeah. Why do you have to do such, like...
Big veins on the neck.
You just pulled your eyelids down. You don't need to do that.
It's just frightening. I think one of the days they're just going to, their heads are going
to
pop off.
The fact that if I went up to one of those Atlas stones and just even tried to move it, I wouldn't be able to move it at all.
Yeah.
Their strength is incredible.
Yeah. It is unbelievable. And at the end, they had to do that deadlift.
Yeah.
One of them was 250 kilograms.
Do you know what?
I mean, that's insane.
Right. This is true now. This isn't a lie again. Okay.
One of them farted so much, no, it blew the other contestant out the fire doors.
The queen, when she was still alive, right, mm-hmm. she used to have one of the world's strongest men in the corner of the living room. And he just used to crack walnuts.
What, with his butt cheeks?
No, with his leg, with his thighs. It's true, 100% true.
Do you know what? It is weird because when they go to seed... It is a useless sort of skill because it's like when you've been a footballer, you can sort of be a commentator and you can wear one of those nice shirts.
They can be like, no, but they go into training, don't they? They train other strongmen.
But otherwise, they're just walking around being cute.
Or, no.
Here, Dave, we need some paint. And he just brings all the paint on his back.
But have you ever, this is true as well.
It's good to have a strongman
around
the house.
Have you ever seen that charity? You know, like there's that... Heroes charity for British armed forces.
Yeah.
There's a charity for ex world's strongest men.
What's it called?
It's called the Charity for World's Strongest Men.
Fucking liar. I love these.
And what they do is they find them employment as bouncers
in
nightclubs across the country. And that's where they go. Right. That's where they all go.
And just picking people
up. And then, well, there's a tier system. So the top tier is you get to be a bouncer at a nightclub. Second tier is you get to be a bouncer at like security in a supermarket.
Right.
The bottom tier.
Garden centre.
No, showing people where to park at car parks.
Love it, yeah.
That's the bottom.
They just pick up cars and just...
Yeah.
But it is that sort of thing of... I think sometimes I'd love to have that strength.
I'd love you to be able to throw me around.
One of them, like they showed one of them with his wife.
Yeah.
She was like tiny.
I know.
I think she was tiny. When they have a romantic moment.
He crushed her once. Imagine Did you hear that on the news?
But imagine after Valentine's Day, she has to book the chiropractor.
I know, that poor lass who got crushed by a strong man.
You're not coming anywhere near me with those arms.
I know.
It's like a big...
That's why I've often thought about if I do Strictly, I would need Kai to be my partner.
Why?
He's got to be a big fella. To be able to throw me around.
Oh, wow,
it would be a right job. I'm 12 stone. Yeah. That's a lot of weight to pick up.
Yeah. But I could not believe. I can't. It's become like a thing. Like I do worry about them afterwards. Because they... Where do you go?
Where do you go where?
As a world's strongest man. No one knows who you are afterwards. They're like, I'm the world's strongest man.
Who was that one that...
And they're constantly doing competitions.
Jeff Capes, was it? Was Jeff Capes the one who did it for us?
Yeah.
And what was that other one called?
I don't know.
There was two that I would really recognise the faces of them.
Yeah.
Jeff Capes was one. Is it Jeff Capes? Have I got it right?
Jeff Capes, yeah.
And
But I don't know.
Where did they do it?
All over the world, mate.
Did they?
Yeah. That was in Glasgow yesterday. But then they're
cold.
They're off to California.
That's cold, though,
isn't
it?
They're doing all sorts.
People
watch it as well.
Yeah. I remember, I told you, didn't I, there was a bloke I worked with, Simon, who was a bodybuilder.
He was massive.
He was.
He was a beast.
And he, but when he was in training, so for competition, he would just eat tuna all the time.
That's
like a couple of tins of tuna at lunchtime. So you'd always know when Simon was eating because the staff room would just smell of fish.
Oh, there's a lot of mercury going down your face, that, isn't it?
Well, that's, you know... That's the downside.
I always think, though, is that you have to work out then, though, because if you stop going to the gym, you just get fat, don't you?
I don't think they do get fat, though. I think it just the muscle wastes away a bit.
But you know, but you're always that size. If your body's, when you see them, and when you know, when they do the posing thing, apparently they don't drink water, do they? Because the more dehydrated they get, the more the muscle definition's there.
Really?
So they don't drink water.
There's a real science to it.
And they shrivel.
Yeah, there's a real science to it, isn't there?
But their hearts must be under incredible stress.
Oh, I don't know. I don't like the sound of it.
But it is mad to think that they can pick up that amount of
weight. It's extreme stuff, isn't it? This isn't like run-of-the-mill being fit. This is like you're pushing your body to an extreme.
Yeah.
And I'm not a fan of extremes.
I wouldn't want to be that big.
I like the pop group Extreme. They were good, weren't they?
I wouldn't want to be that
but
big.
But I don't like extremes. I don't like extreme weather.
No, you don't.
I don't.
You
like...
do though.
Oh, always... I've just lied again. I'm lying all podcast today.
You want to be a storm
I love a tornado. That's an extreme, but that's the only one I like.
Part of you.
I do quite like a tsunami as well. Obviously, I don't like tsunamis. I don't.
You don't cheer them
on. No, but I find them fascinating.
Like,
is what
right
I'm
now,
saying.
Part of you. Obviously, you don't want to be in the dangerous bit, but part of you would love to be in America looking at that snowdrift.
I don't think I would, actually. That extreme, I really don't like. I don't like those extremes. And I'm scared of heat.
What? Extreme heat?
Oh, that terrifies
These
me.
These people who run that marathon in the desert.
Oh, idiots.
But you need a van alongside you.
Yeah, it's stupid.
Whole support team. Death Valley Marathon.
Stupid.
My friend who did the marathon disables in the desert.
I know. Lost his toenails, nearly died. Idiot!
He had to sleep in a sand dune.
I can't bear it.
Ran with an handkerchief on his head. Isn't that impressive?
No!
What about your dad doing the Bob Graham? Is that idiotic?
Quite, yeah. It is, really.
What is the Bob Graham? Running all the peaks in all the mountains in the Lake District, isn't it?
Yeah.
In one day, like that, 24 Stupid. Hours running consistently. You have to have a team feeding you jelly babies into your tired face. So you think that's stupid as well?
Yeah.
Your own father?
Yeah.
Think his project was a vanity project?
Yeah.
Personal goal? Not it's achieved?
Just an idiot. I'm not a fan of extreme weather. I'm not a fan of extreme muscles.
Extreme
or fitness.
Muscles?
Yeah, you know, where you go one or the other. I just like run-of-the-mill me.
Yeah.
Run of the mill.
I want to go back to the gym. That's probably one of my resolutions.
I don't like extreme diets where you eat like loads of protein. I just want run of the mill middle ground.
Yeah.
Everything in moderation. I think it's probably why I never like getting drunk because it's extreme. I don't like...
So you're quite...
I'm quite dull. I'm quite vanilla, aren't I, really?
You're Madagascan vanilla, mate, you are. I saw on Twitter that someone at a car boot had taken a picture of someone selling Hermes unopened packages on a big trestle table.
What, that they're nicked?
In a lucky dip for £2.
Get lost.
No. So it was like a long table
and
it had like all different packages and it was like lucky dip, £2. And like there were people going, oh, it's an iPhone. Not that level, but just... sort of random stuff. How bonkers is that?
Was it stolen then?
Well, I would imagine it's fallen into their lap. But it was a genuine picture.
So did somebody ring the police?
Yeah, I think they did. But don't you think, like, I haven't been to a car boot in ages.
I
wanted to talk car boots is, because it's a Sunday, I was thinking of all the Sunday activities. Car boots is one of the king things.
Yeah.
I used to love them as a kid.
Yeah, I love
car
boots.
And I want to go to one.
Well, do you then?
But you got to get up at, like, I remember your uncle. Was a big car boot.
Yeah, you have to. You
got
to
be up at five. You got to be up at five.
No, he never said
six.
That.
You got to be up six.
But you have to
by
be there.
Seven. It's all gone.
You have to be there early if you want the bargains.
But you got all the good stuff's gone by eight. Yeah. You wander in at 10. You're buying toilet brushes and shit, aren't you?
Yeah, you've got to be there early.
But then it's sort of weird how people are in your boot, like sort of scavenging around.
Yeah.
Because we've sort of sold stuff at car boots before, and you're very good at giving stuff away. For nothing. You're like, 25p that.
You've never 25p. Done a car boot with me.
I remember when we were selling stuff on the school field and you were giving away their kids' toys and some of them were expensive toys. You were like, 20p, 20p for the lot.
Yeah.
You just wanted to get rid of it. And I was like, 20p?
Yeah.
It's cheaper for me to drive to the tip and get rid of it.
No, it isn't. That's ridiculous.
20 pence. You were selling stuff at daft money.
No, it's just to get rid of it. You just want to get rid.
What are your car boot memories as a kid?
I haven't really got any, but I do remember going to a car boot, but I've done a few. I did one with my mum and dad. And I think the key to it is not going overpriced because otherwise you'll never shift anything.
Mm.
People who overprice stuff, you just walk away.
People have got a really skewed view of their own shit, haven't they?
Yeah.
They're like, I remember
some of it is just tart and it needs to go in the bin.
One guy was selling VHS like box sets of Lord of the Rings, tenner. I was like, mate.
Yeah.
We're on downloads now.
Yeah.
What are you doing? We haven't even got videos anymore.
No.
Just
You can't sell this for a tenner.
No, the people do try and get rid of a load of rubbish, don't they?
Yeah.
But you do get some good bits as well. It's a bit like eBay. When you know that it's a dealer on eBay, you kind of don't feel the buzz of buying something. And it's the same with car boots. If they're a professional car booter.
Yeah.
I sort of like, it's not thrilling to get something that how do you know they've overpriced. And
how do you know they're professional, though?
Just
the way they've got set up. They've got chip and pin.
The thing they've got, no, not necessarily chip and pin, but just, yeah, it's just too organised almost and too, yeah. You know somebody who's literally shoved what's in their loft in their car and then they just splay it all out on the floor and it's just like, yes, this is
we want someone who's as confused as we are. Yeah. Who sort of wandered in there innocently, just throwing stuff that's like heirlooms, an antiques roadshow level.
Yeah.
That's an original constable. Yeah. How much do you want? 25p, just selling. Yeah. They haven't got a clue what they're selling.
No.
You need those vulnerable people.
Yes.
But they're the ones that sort of get hit first by the professional booters because they see them coming in and they think they're not even organised.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Is if you they haven't got a pricing system.
Well, if you went every week, you'd soon get to know who's, you know, the ones over there all the time.
It's Tony, is it?
But yeah, my uncle Chris used to do the rounds. He used to go to all the regular booths.
In one day?
I don't know if he'd do it in one day, but he'd sort of alternate, you know. He'd know where the local car boots were going on.
Weird Cossle's got a car boot this Sunday, mate.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever bought anything. I remember buying one thing as a kid, a Star Wars toy. Mm. And I did think at the time, I think I've done well.
Yeah.
You know, as a kid, you think them parents don't realise what they're selling.
No.
It's like £3. Yeah. And I was like, that's a Star Destroyer for £3. You fucked up.
Yeah.
Then you head your life. As you pay for it, you go, you fucked up.
Yeah.
You ain't done your research, old lady.
Mm.
You're that's selling what you this. Want. Your son's left home. You're trying to clear your loft.
You want,
they're the ones you want to pick off.
Yeah, you want vulnerable. Not vulnerable.
Vulnerable, you do.
Gullible.
Stupid.
Gullible.
Yeah, unclueless. Like my dad, when I left home, just flogged everything in that loft and he didn't care. There was stuff that was collectible. There was Fred Perry's. There was an Amiga with rare games. All for a fiver. Get it out my life.
Yeah.
That was a mistake.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to do that with our kids. I'm going to hold on to the stuff which is of value.
Well, our loft is a disgrace. I mean, it would be easier to do. Maybe we should do a car boot.
What do you mean?
Because we could take stuff to the tip, but
if we did a car boot,
it might be.
We can't do a car boot.
We could make a bob or two.
No, we wouldn't, because you'd be giving it away to make people happy. You'd be like, can someone come up and try it on and be like, can I have all that on the mat there for a fiver? You'd be like, no, go on then.
Yeah, there's a lot of crap up there though, good God. But I have to say, Brew Crew, Happy New Year.
Yeah. It's Happy New Year.
We made it.
It's 2023. Can you believe it's 23?
I know. And as a teacher, I will continually write 2022 on the board for the four coming months because you always forget to change it.
Yeah.
But I was just going to say, it's quite momentous, really. This is episode 51. We are rapidly approaching a year of Brew with the Bennets.
And we will coincide a year. This podcast will be released a year and it will go out on Black Monday.
Oh.
The day that people's credit cards...
It doesn't go out on Black Monday.
It will do. The 52th.
No, we go out on a Sunday.
Yeah, well, it'll be Grey Monday. Grey Sunday.
Right, okay.
The prelude to Black Monday.
Through,
I didn't.
You?
That was awful.
No, but what I was going to say was we're rapidly approaching a year of Brew with the Bennets. We have had over 25,000 downloads, I checked at last look. Yeah, which is averaging 500 downloads a week, which... When you talk to the big boys in the game, that's small fry. They get 25,000 downloads
talk to
a
the
day.
Big, when do you talk to the big boys
in the game? I never
talk
to the
game.
Big boys. Never talk to them. I don't know any
go,
big boys.
Can I speak to the big boys in the game, please?
Hang on just a minute. Hello?
All right. Who
can
do you
I
want?
Speak to the big boys in the game, please?
This is the big boy in the game.
How many downloads do you get a day?
100,000.
Okay. Just forget it. Bye.
Bye.
So, yeah, we don't compete with that, but... In our own little Brew Crew world, I think that's quite nice.
It is nice
that you guys are listening every week, and we have had so many We've had tens of messages.
Tens of messages. Tens of messages, Gemma.
No, we've had some lovely messages on Insta, emails, Twitter, people thanking us and saying that they've listened to the podcast whilst, I don't know, walking the dog, whilst on a shift, whilst driving to work. And
well, I've got one here.
Go.
Reese Beresford said he's a window cleaner and he works alone.
Yay, Reese.
So he said it's nice to have some familiar voices twice a week and it doesn't make the days feel like I'm working on my own.
No. That's nice.
It must look like I must look like a nutter. People see me on the other side of the windows.
Laughing. Yeah. I know. Well, that's what I do. I listen to podcasts all the time and listen. We also had a message from a blast from the past for you, Scott, Nikki. She says, hi, Scott. I'm currently in Gran Canaria and have discovered your Brew with the Bennetts podcast and absolutely love it. You've come a long way since the days of racing up and down my Auntie Peggy's drive with me, Michael and Catherine. So this is a family friend, isn't it? Auntie Peggy and Uncle Terry.
Auntie Peggy, Uncle. Which, not real aunties or uncles. It's
no,
just
but we
how,
love them just the same.
How the North works.
And I did text Peggy yesterday because she sent the kids some Christmas money. She always does. She's so kind. Yeah. It's lovely to hear you and Gemma talk about your mum and dad, so Max and Roy. I loved it when they visited Auntie Peggy, as both were full of life and laughter. And I have to say, they're no different now, Nikki. They are still
dynamos of energy.
Keep up the good work. The energy between you and Gem is brilliant and hilarious, Nikki.
Wow.
Oh, so
that
nice.
Is a blast from the past.
Thank
I don't
you.
I don't fully remember her. I don't know why.
Don't say that. You'd say, oh, Nikki.
Oh, we're so close.
No,
we're
you
so
do
close.
Remember,
I do remember
don't you? Because we did, Nikki, we did mention it to Mags and Roy on Christmas Day as well. And they were like, oh, Nikki, we haven't seen you for so long. So love to you.
Love to you, Nikki.
Love to you.
Thank you so much for listening. In Gran Canaria.
I know.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Also, Dave and Emma, thank you. You say, hi, Scott and Gemma. Just wanted to drop you a quick line to say, hope you and the kids have a very Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. We've seen Scott twice in 2022 and look forward to seeing him again in 2023. Your podcast and afternoon tea have kept us smiling in 2022. Keep up the good work. That's so nice. And it's Dave Cornerbath.
Lots of 2020. Oh, he's in his Cornerbath like Scarface. Oh, I love
it. And he did say, P.S., when are you taking Gemma on tour as your support act? When hell freezes over, Dave.
Well, we've heard Gemma and her thoughts, haven't we?
Not
so
happening.
I want to take some of those on tour, Gemma and her thoughts.
Oh, no. I think we'll, what's the word?
What?
Don't inflict that on the world. Also, Paul McGeady, friend of the show. Paul started listening to us way, way back in the Shed Show.
Yeah.
Lynn is his fiancé, isn't it? And Dexter the dog. Yeah. So he wished us a Merry Christmas on Twitter. So Merry Christmas to you. And also, big, massive shout out. Can't go without saying to Saz and Steve and Mabel the dog. We just wanted to say thank you so much for all your correspondence. They've written to us basically every week since we started the pod. And your support has been so great.
They've written to us more than I wrote to you.
When I was in Germany.
When you were in Germany and you are my wife.
Yeah. And even on Instagram, Tina, always getting messages from Tina. She's so great. And everybody who takes part in like our Insta feeds, look, if you could give a follow to What Laura Loves up in, she's up in the North
East. Shields.
She's fantastic. And she always supports us. So thank you to her. I'm just looking down here. Sorrel, thank you for the fashion inspiration, Sorrel, because I've got my new suit for when I go to the Panto at the end of the month.
Hang on a minute, we need to pause on this.
What?
You're going for a full red suit.
I'm going pillarbox.
Pillarbox red.
I cannot
jacket
wait.
Jacket and trousers.
Yeah.
Do you know what you're going to look like?
Go on.
Devil Wears Prada, mate.
I can't wait.
It's going to be power suit.
I can't wait.
You're going to look like what was her in Rocky IV called? What was her name? Come on.
Bridget Nielsen.
Yeah. You're going to go Bridget Nielsen.
But Helen Rich on Insta, she's always replying to us.
Yeah.
Charlotte Marshall, Jamie Street, Matt Hutchins, Debs, of course, me mate Debs, Lola Pearson, Claire Rowbotham. Do you say it like that?
I don't know.
Colin Valance, Sorrel, Simone Fitzpatrick. Of course, give a shout out to Alice Kellett, who's an artist and she's always supporting us. Rachel Coe and Lexi on Insta, my netballing mates. Andrew Hooker always shouts out. Louise, my old mate, McMahon. Louisa, Sarah Bromley,
Jimmy,
Karen
Berish. You can't keep going with
this. Lorna Hallam, Mags Williamson, Tina and Chris Richmond and Faith in Fasting. And just anyone. I've missed loads. There's so many. I can't even mention them all, but you always respond. You write. You say hello. I'm sorry if I've missed you there because I can't. There's so many.
Who is still buying Cliff Richard albums?
Cliff Richard fans.
Who, though?
Derek.
Derek?
I'm just naming names.
But have you seen the album? It's no. Just doing... It is even the video for it, they put it on telly the other day. Mm. It looks like he don't want to do it anymore.
He does. He loves it. He loves Christmas.
He looks uncomfortable.
He loves Christmas.
He doesn't. He looks uncomfortable, does Cliff? He looks like he's been pushed into it now. And he's got his sleeve rolls up. He's too old to be doing it now.
No.
He is. He looked uncomfortable.
He loves Christmas, does our Cliff.
But I think it must be now. The only people buying it now are people who have no choice in their decisions. Mm. I think it's piped in. I think they're in. I think there's people just in old folks' homes who can't have access to the radio.
Mm.
Who is buying Cliff?
I don't know.
Who is buying it?
I don't know, but we've had Bublé on a lot. That's one thing I know.
I know, but you've never thought...
Christmas Bublé.
You've never thought, let's get Cliff on.
Christmas Cliff. There must be somebody out there who's listening to him. We did watch the King's Speech, didn't we, on Christmas Day?
We did,
Day.
Yeah.
Old Charlie boy.
It's a big old gig for Charlie, that, wasn't it?
The first
one off the bat.
He does... I think he's got... If you watch the way he does speeches, he'll every now and again look down. So
really?
It's his way of, like... He delivers
words.
A little bit, very sincere, and then he'll look down. And it's his way of taking a pause to sort of gather himself and look at probably the next bit. I mean, he has an auto cue for sure.
Do you know what was interesting?
Go on.
They didn't show his hands.
Oh, the sausage fingers.
No, and I think they did that on purpose. I think they thought...
Well, it made everybody hungry, wouldn't it, for the Christmas dinner?
All people be thinking is, get them pigs in blankets.
That's
on.
It, exactly. Wouldn't it have been funny if he'd had bacon wrapped around?
Little Christmas. I want to say... I can't do the impression
you're doing,
of Charles.
You're doing Thatcher.
Thatcher.
Charles isn't Thatcher.
Just want to say, everyone, well done this year. It's been a tough year for everyone. Now get stuck into these.
Yeah.
Just get some up.
No. Have you put your sausages in?
Just what you're thinking. Get your pigs in blankets
pop,
on.
Pop your pigs in blankets on.
A little bit of cranberry on his little finger instead of that little ring. Yeah. Little cranberry.
Can we just do a post-match analysis of how we dished up Christmas dinner?
Well, you can do,
10 out of 10.
You nailed
10
it.
10 out of 10. No, as a team, though, I mean, I did nail the cooking.
We slipped into some sort of soup
kitchen.
So
what we had was...
It was a system.
We had the three meats in the corner.
Three meats.
Scott was on carving, right?
Yeah, I was on carving.
Okay. We had the plates at the ready.
You did...
We had... roasted potatoes on the top of the oven.
We had covers like a restaurant. Yeah. You gave me a list.
Now, one thing that...
Like I was in a restaurant on a pass.
I had my warming plate. What do you call it? It's like a little warming tray.
Hostess trolley without a trolley.
Well, it's like a... You know, it's one of them things where you've got like three little compartments and it keeps it all warm with
lids on. Do you
know what
Jason Cook says about them?
What?
Because the skin won't form on its own.
What?
As in you leave it in there, everything skins over.
Oh, right. Okay. So we had sprouts in there
nice.
And my carrots in there with a bit of butter on just so they were nice and
look at
moist.
You loved it, didn't
and
you?
And then I had I was okay to put my cauliflower cheese out on top because that holds its heat for ages. It's absolutely piping
it's
up.
It's the centre of the
so
earth.
So that was okay. And then I had my pigs in blankets in the warming thing as well. So literally you would put the meat on.
Well, you give me an order
first.
I
took down.
You'd go, dad one.
Yeah.
Chicken, beef, turkey.
Yeah, so you put that on. Then we put the potatoes on because they hold their heat for ages. Then pigs in blankets, veg, dollop of the thingy on, stuffing ball, gravy, serve up. And it was just so, it
was
just worked, didn't it?
It
worked.
It was like we were running a restaurant, mate.
It was really good.
It was a level of communication that gives me faith that we can get another 10 years out of this marriage.
Well.
All we need to do is to make sure we're doing a Christmas dinner every day. And our communication channels are open, baby.
Yeah, it was good.
It was phenomenal.
It worked.
It was.
I think, we'll do that system again.
What do you mean?
The
pass.
The conveyor belt system. Yeah, the pass.
I loved how
service!
You
Let's talk resolutions, okay?
Oh, I hate this.
Oh, well, it's got to be done. It's got to be done. Have you got any New Year's resolutions? Bearing in mind that last year, live on the pod, I told everybody I wanted to join an orchestra. Failed.
Yeah.
Right? What was the other one I wanted to do? Was it write a book?
Yeah.
I am writing one, so that's kind of half done.
Did you say you were going to join an orchestra?
Yeah.
Well, you bought a clarinet that's never been used.
That was years ago. I bought that years ago. Yeah. No, I do use it once a year at the carol service.
Wow. That's been worth it.
So this year, what I'm thinking is, I did start to... Well, oh no, I joined a netball team.
Yeah, was I that did a resolution? Do that.
I think it was to join a team sports type thing. So I've did that, so that's good. And I started doing Zumba again, and I really enjoy that. Not done a lot of it over Christmas, though. This bloody cold is going on forever and ever and ever. And I know everybody's saying it across the nation. Everybody's got the same virus, haven't they?
It's been mental.
It's awful.
I nearly lost my voice. I'm still struggling.
I know. You're terrified, aren't you?
I'm terrified of losing my voice. It's there. It's an ongoing threat. And then I had a bit of a weird turn on Christmas Eve. Do you remember?
I do.
Stomach acid during four weddings and a funeral.
Honestly,
sat there going, I think I'm going to hurl you.
It's awful.
And I did. Happy Christmas.
Oh, it was
like the old days of being 18 again.
It was a disaster.
I think it is. I think it's... Well, you set some realistic...
Targets.
Resolutions.
Resolutions. Okay. So, here we go. Resolution number one. Me time.
That sounds ominous.
So, I think we really, really, really need to do this year.
Right.
Have some time together. Us.
Us time. Not me time.
Okay, us time.
Me time sounds like you want less time together.
Yeah.
Me time sounds like you want to rearrange.
Let me think this through. No, yeah. So
us time.
I think we always say it and it doesn't happen.
Yeah, I agree.
And I think it's important.
Yeah. Yeah. So what does that entail though?
Well, I know I fancy a bit of a spa.
You love a spa.
I love a spa.
So you're saying let's book a spa day then?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And just think.
But a lot of those mean silence and not speaking to each other
that
day.
No, it doesn't. You can have a right good chinwag at a spa.
Really?
Yeah.
Aren't you getting on everyone's tits though?
No, of course you're not.
Okay.
When I've been with my mates, we chat all day.
I do agree what you're saying. I think we need to do some us time.
Yeah. And you've said you're really going to try hard, like next Christmas, book it off.
I know.
Really book it off.
In the cold light of day... When I'm facing the fact that I've got to work in between Christmas and New Year, I now think, oh, that was a shit idea.
It's a terrible idea.
I know, and I think
and
at the time...
And it's family time, you know
it,
that.
It is. And it's one of those things where you're trying to straddle two worlds, aren't you? You're trying to make sure that everything's... I don't know, that you're keeping the money coming in, but also, you know, and then now I'm thinking, oh, God, I shouldn't have done that. And now you're going to be up with mum and dad's and I'm going to have to shuttle run back.
Yeah.
Because I've booked gigs on my doorstep here.
Yeah.
Thinking we might be around here.
But you knew we wouldn't be.
I know, but I thought we might be.
No, we won't be.
Yeah.
Ever.
Yeah.
So anyway, so I think that for next year.
Resolution.
Yeah.
What? Some us time.
Yeah, and just some proper chunks of time off. You need time off. You need time to... I think that's the thing. It's not about materialism. It's not about we want this or we want that. It's about time. Time.
I think the thing is, though, it's been such a weird few years for everyone that I think people are panicked about money and panicked about... Just, I don't know. It's a weird thing. You know what happens with my job is when you're in demand, you feel like you should... capitalize on it because you worry how long it's gonna last for and then one day they're gonna turn around and go, oh, we don't need you anymore.
Yeah, I know.
And then you sort of like you've missed the boat.
Yes, I understand.
Because if I was around all day here, I think you'd be like, can you not get a gig? I think you'd be like,
yeah,
surely you can get a gig somewhere.
Yeah, maybe.
Do you know what I mean? I don't know. But I understand what you're saying. So your resolution is to spend more time with me.
Oh, have I just said that?
Effectively.
Ooh.
Oh, now you're backing out, is it?
No. And also, I think going back to the, you know, my mum always says, me time. What the bloody hell's me time? I never had me time. And I know what she's saying. But I just think it is important just to...
Well, like, her going down the allotment was her me time.
Well, it still is.
This is the thing.
She loves her allotment.
People have me time. They don't know it's me time.
I think it's... It is just important. Self-care is what it's about, isn't it? Because life's very, very busy. And I've got a book to my left here. I received some beautiful books over Christmas. We both did, didn't we?
Yeah.
A lot of... We do like a biography, don't we? An autobiography.
I love a biography.
I love an autobiography.
I like reading about listening to someone's life.
We like a bit of comedy, and we also like a bit of...
Do you know what I've been thinking, though? It's, if I ever get a chance to write a biography, I'm going to have to lie.
Why?
Because I don't think it's very exciting, my life.
Oh, dear. Here we go.
Do you know what I mean? Because then you have to write things like... that. You hear some biographies like... Russell Brands or someone like that, they've had such an amazing life that you think, oh, people are going to want to read about that. Who's going to want to read about me helping my dad paint some railings?
And then I went to work with Roy and we decorated a fish and chip shop and I went up a ladder and one day I slipped down two rungs. Nothing happened, I just hurt my foot. That was that day. Chapter 2.
The thing is...
Tidy in a shed. It just... I don't know.
The thing is, I think all of us could think that. If you said, oh, I've not done anything or, you know...
If you were writing your biography...
But if you actually start... If you start really delving into stuff, probably all of us have got something that would be... Because actually, sometimes, there's great interest in mundanity.
Is there? Oh, yeah. I hope so, because that's all this podcast is.
No, because if you think about social history, and I love social history, you know, just the analysis of... And looking through the window into a period of time, just at general day-to-day life, I find that really fascinating.
Really?
Yeah.
So if you were writing your biography then, what sort of key moments would there be, though, in your life?
Oh, I can't sum it up now. I couldn't possibly sum it up.
But you're talking about the mundanity. I can't...
No, but I'm just saying, you know, the process of writing an autobiography is quite, like, you just have to... You really have to sort of... I don't know...
Think back you through to, your
yeah you would really sort of trawl back through your life, wouldn't you? Which you can't just do now. You can't just do it in a nutshell, can you?
But this, I don't even think there's been that significant moments. I'm trying to think back.
Well, all I was going to say was, you got for Christmas can I have my ball back,
yeah, the Richard Herring one.
Yeah, so I want to borrow that after you've read it. And I got the Matthew Perry autobiography, which
Again, he's had demons. I've had no demons.
Scott, why are you talking like everybody wants an autobiography about you?
I don't know.
Why is it worrying you?
Because
you'll probably never, ever have an autobiography, so don't worry about
it. Someone might ask me. Someone might ask me, and then I'm going to have to think of
Sorry, I can't clear my throat.
I know. You sound and like then, a machine gun. A kid doing a machine gun impression.
Yeah. And then so Matthew Perry, I think that might be... I think it'll be a lot of... interesting stuff, but it's also going to be a bit
it's
of
gonna
a
be
tough
a bit
one.
Sad, Jen.
Tough read.
It's going to be a bit sad in places. Yeah. You're not very good with sad.
No, I know.
That's a weird biography for you.
Then I got one about the perimenopause. My friend bought me that, which I think is going to be fascinating.
Yeah.
Then I got, my brother bought me a brilliant philosophy book, but it's based on children's philosophy on life.
Right.
And I can't wait to read that.
Oh, do you know what should be in there?
Yeah.
Before Christmas. Mm-hmm. Oh, that was funny, wasn't it? Sophia at school, this happens at school between groups of kids, I think. They were all sort of stood there, her and her mates, and they're saying what skills they had.
Yeah.
Now that happens a lot when you're a kid.
Yeah.
So they say stuff like, oh, I can do a handstand or I can run really fast. And Sophia panicked and thought, I need to say something because I don't want to look like I've got nothing. And she said, well, I can read minds. So what philosophy
she
is that?
She swore me to secrecy.
I know,
that.
But it's
and
beautiful.
I can't believe you've
I love it, though.
It.
What I love about it is it's such a dick swinging moment because it's so like you can keep your handstand, you can keep your fast running, I can read minds. But then she's got to prove it.
I feel really bad about this.
What?
Because she told me never to
She's
tell
never going
to
listen to our podcast. I think it's so
she
sweet.
She might listen to it.
Don't be so stupid. I think it's that. What I'm saying is, in terms of philosophy, don't you think that's quite interesting from a child's point of view? That she's gone, I'm going to go big and I'm going to.
Why is that philosophy?
Is it philosophy? No, that's psychology. That's similar, but it's not the same.
No, it's not the same at all.
No. Don't you think it's sweet, though, that?
No.
Why?
I think it's lying.
Yeah, but you can always lie as a kid.
No, I don't think I was a liar.
You were. You
no,
will
I
have
wasn't.
Lied.
I
lied.
No.
We
I
all
wasn't
lied.
A liar. And in fact, I was. I was a campaigner for justice, and I remember...
What a square.
I know.
I remember... A campaigner for justice, you saddo.
There was a friend
like a
of mine who told
counselor.
A lie, and I outed her.
Oh, I bet she loved that. You outed her? Ooh, you little rat. What did you out her for? What was the lie?
She said she went for dinner with Kylie Minogue.
And you went... No,
you didn't.
How did you out her?
Can't remember.
You just said, I want to see the evidence.
Yeah.
And she said, I can't.
Can't give you any.
What did Kylie have? Yeah. Chips.
Yeah.
Did you interrogate her on it?
Yeah. I was like, no, you didn't.
I wouldn't. You didn't go for dinner with Kylie.
I call you on it. I smell BS.
What, really?
Yeah.
Do you know what, though? You can lie a bit, though, when you're younger, you can. Yeah. You sort of, it's without consequence.
I suppose so.
Because it's no one's going to follow up on it,
out.
Really.
Knock yourself out. I think, can you imagine you as can an read adult minds. If you did that?
What do you mean?
Like, just lied all the time. Like, oh, I've got a Ferrari at home.
Yeah.
No, you haven't. Yeah. You have.
My dad is Lionel Messi.
Well, show me it. Yeah. Show me your Ferrari. I can't. It's in the garage.
It's in the garage, mate. It's MOT.
We'll bring it next week. It'll be in the garage again.
It's in the garage, mate.
Just keep getting out of it. My wife's borrowed it. But sticking to it absolutely 100% yeah. that you've definitely got a Ferrari.
I went for a drink with Lionel Messi last night.
Who's Lionel Messi?
The Argentinian footballer.
I thought it was Lionel.
It's Lionel.
I thought it was Lionel Messi.
No, you're thinking Lionel Blair. Lionel Messi.
No, I'm thinking of Lionel Richie. Dancing on a ceiling.
No, but you could say, I went for a drink with Lionel Messi last night. No, you didn't. I did.
Yeah. And I went for a drink with Tess Daly.
Yeah. Same pub.
Same pub.
Wickham Webster.
Me and Tess Daly are the best friends.
Yeah.
Actually, he bought me for Christmas some Sanctuary bath stuff. Do you know Tess Daly's 53?
Get out.
She looks bloody good.
The richer you are, the better you look.
Do you think so?
Yeah, there's something in that. No. There is. Definitely.
No, but I watched The Detectorist last night and Mackenzie Crook looks quite old, doesn't he?
He does look old. Bless him. Love that programme.
He looks quite weathered.
He needs a wash. It looks like he needs a wash. It looks like
he's
has...
a good actor though, isn't
he? He's amazing and it's an... Oh, it was so good. I loved it last night. But he does look like he's permanently in Wurzel Gummidge.
Yeah.
Sort of like he's rugged. He's Wurzel. Do you know what he looks like?
Yeah.
He looks like a walking wash leather.
Yeah.
Sort of weathered, like you say. Looks like an Aborigine tribe, not a tribesman. He just looks like
a
red Indian.
He's 93.
No, he's not. He does. It looks like he's been preserved in vinegar.
He looks like he could be in the Rolling Stones.
He
does. You know, he lives that rock and roll lifestyle.
He is Rolling Stones. He's Ronnie Wood.
Him and Ronnie Wood?
Yeah.
They
look the same age.
Brother from a mother and lover.
Brother from a mother lover? A brother from another mother?
No, brother from another lover.
Mother?
Mother lover.
Mother lover, another mother. Do you know what it is, though? It's like, you know when you used to get a conker and you'd pickle it?
Yeah.
It looks like an age.
No, I've never done that. I don't know why I said yeah.
But he does.
No idea.
Some people age quite dramatically.
Mm.
I think you're going to age quite well.
I think men can embrace age better than women. Women fight it all the way.
Yeah.
Puffing out every wrinkle and I'm just... who was I talking to who said about photographs and stuff?
What?
Just the fact that I'll take stupid photographs. But I was just saying, oh, yeah, it was your mum.
Right.
Yeah, because she knows I take daft photographs and stuff for Instagram and that. And I said, I just don't care.
What do you mean?
Like, if I look bad in a photograph, I don't care.
I know what you mean.
Because it's just like, maybe it's my stage in life, but I don't care.
Well, you don't care what you look like.
Well, that's not true. I don't. It's not that I don't care what I look like.
It's a good attitude to have.
But I also don't care about somebody looking at a photograph and going, oh, look at the wrinkles on her neck. Or I just think, well, so?
Yeah. Doesn't matter, does
it? Doesn't matter.
No, and I think you have to, in a weird way, I think you have to, what you said is true. Men do age better than women.
Yeah.
In a weird way, don't they?
Yeah.
Why is that?
Well, no, it's not that they age better.
Oh,
I think they can allow, it's almost like a man with grey hair, like standard is that women wear makeup, men don't.
Mm.
Standard is that women start dyeing their hair to cover up grey. Men don't have to do that. I know some men do dye their hair, but you don't ever think that's the default with men, do you?
I wonder if I'm just going to go like overnight, just go from sort of thick blonde. I'm just going to wake up in the morning full silver fox.
I don't think it'll just happen quick. I don't think so because your dad gradually went greyer.
Yeah.
And I think you have got your dad's hair colour in, haven't you?
I don't know. My mum's hair's ridiculous.
It's lovely hair. And we saw Rula Lenska was on... TV yesterday and she looked fabulous.
Oh, that's
her
a
age.
Weird program that they were on.
She's the same age as your dad. She's 75.
Did you see that program though?
But she's got a massive thick head of hair and I do think good hair makes you look younger.
They were sat in a shed with Alan Titchmarsh, and it was on for 2 hours.
Mm.
And it was just Alan, her, some other people, in a shed.
Mm.
And he was in his waistcoat.
Well, it was a set, wasn't it?
I know, but it's just like, who puts Alan on for 2 hours?
I love Alan.
It's a bit odd, wasn't it?
I love all the Alans. I love Alan Bennett. I love Alan Titchmarsh.
Go on, give
us another Alan. I love Alan Partridge.
It's not real Alan.
Yeah,
fictitious
but
Alan.
But he's an Alan.
Alan Wicker, he's gone.
No, I didn't. Alan, I wasn't keen on him.
Who was your other favourite Alan?
Alan Adale.
Alan Adale never existed. Alan.
Alan. Tim Allen.
Tim
liked
Allen?
Him.
Yeah, it's not an Alan.
He has got Alan in his name.
Alan Rickman.
I loved Alan Rickman.
I loved Alan Rickman.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, Detectorists was very good, I think, the point that we're trying to make.
Was it?
Yeah, it was excellent.
I don't remember the point we were making anyway.
I don't know. Mackenzie Crook looked old.
Oh, yeah.
But it's a do you know what I love about The Detectorist? It's that pacing.
Mm.
It's not frenetic. It's not trying to do too much, is
no.
it? It's just gentle and
yeah.
nice
yeah.
and, oh, it's like a cuddle.
Yeah.
It's comforting.
Yeah.
It's proper comfort telly, isn't it?
Yeah.
There's certain things
yeah.
that...
Yeah.
Programs that make you feel comforted.
Yeah.
And that is one of them.
It's weird as well because it's not an outright laugh a minute, is it? It's not a sitcom in that sense. It's not a sitcom, is it? What was
well,
it? What is it?
It's like
a black comedy,
isn't
it?
It's like a comedy drama, really.
Comedy drama, yeah.
Yeah. It makes me want to be a metal detector, though.
Oh, I've said this before.
It's finding... What is it about finding things?
It's human nature to want to find things.
Like right now, if I said to you, I've got a metal detector, do you want to go in the garden? You'd be digging.
I would.
You'd be out there.
Well, I'd probably go to a park, actually.
What, just wander around a park?
Do you know where I go?
Where?
Wilton Park.
Why?
Because I reckon there's some Elizabethan treasures there.
You've got to get permission first.
Why?
You can't just go and start digging holes, mate.
I wouldn't dig a hole. I'd just detect.
There's no fun in detecting.
And then I'd give them coordinates of where I find something beeping.
Yeah. It's the thing of finding things, isn't it?
You could do that, couldn't you? You could give them a GPS point.
Do you know when I used to say? Do you know when I used to walk home? I remember walking home from school, and at the side of the road, sometimes you'd find stuff like number plates or old spark plugs, and I'd collect them, and I'd walk home with them.
Mm.
And my mum would be like, "You're not bringing all that in the house."
No,
but I don't know. I was at an age where I was like, "I want to
find,
forage,
and discover something important,
and discover."
Yeah.
And I have found the number plate from a 1992 Fiesta.
I think as kids, all kids wanted that. They all wanted to find some treasure.
Yeah.
And that's why, as an adult...
That's a good idea for a theme park.
What?
I've got an idea.
What?
You have a big field and you call it Finding Treasure.
No, because it's not real.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter.
No, it no.
The buzz
it
of it
does.
Is
no.
enough.
No, it does matter. It has to be authentic. Otherwise,
no, it
it's not a buzz.
What do you mean?
If they knew you planted something, that's rubbish.
You don't think you could get the buzz from it?
No.
Even if you knew?
No, what kids want to do is go into a forest or on a beach. Excuse me.
You couldn't find anything. You're just your wind.
All I do, I love it when we go to the beach and I love foraging on a beach.
You just set
I'm
off.
Always convinced I'm going to find something and I never, ever do.
What do you think you're going to find, though?
Treasure.
I think
or
that's
a bottle,
an
message in
I think
a
the buzz of it is is enough.
Yeah. I'm happy for hours on a beach just looking.
Yeah. Well, maybe in the new year we could get a couple of metal detectors each.
That would have been a good present, wouldn't it?
What, a metal detector each?
Yeah.
And then just set off together.
Yeah.
Just wandering about.
Yeah.
The
really
metal
good.
Detecting couple.
That'd have been really
Look
good
Look at
fun.
These two geeks here.
Shall we become the detectorists?
The detector couple, just wandering after the school run, just set off. Where would we go, though? Just wandering through the field.
Yeah.
Together. Oh, that could be
just
good.
Just go down at Attenborough Nature Reserve.
What, and just sort of... It's before you've even switched it on.
Max. Just go around shops.
I'd love that.
In Sainsbury's.
Down near the deli aisle.
I found there's a what do you call it?
What? The end of a sword?
Yeah. An end of a sword in Sainsbury's?
I don't know. What would you find in Sainsbury's?
You might find somebody might have dropped the tool they used to open boxes.
Found this.
Did you I lost that last week.
Just
there you are, found it for you.
Yeah.
It's all right.
Anything else in these finding?
Don't need to thank me. It's a service we provide.
Just a load of old dears following about.
Or we get calls. Like, we become like the fifth emergency service.
Like Ghostbusters. Like,
we've lost our keys. Can you come and find them? No problem.
Get the
in
two.
Your house. Oh, down the back of the sofa. Here you are, madam. There's your keys. Thank you so much. Just we lost them a month ago. Don't worry about
it. Come with the headphones on.
Don't worry about it. Do you need to pay? Do we need to pay you? No, it's just a service we provide. We don't need thanks.
Imagine that. I can't find I can't find my wedding ring.
Yeah.
Soap the dog's ass. The dog's eating it. You're going to have to wait for nature to take its course. He's going to have to shit that out.
Yeah.
Well
done. Don't thank us. It's fine.
What would we call ourselves? Not the detectorists, because that's been done.
Oh. The beepers.
The beepers. I'd love it. Scott and Gemma are the beepers.
Yeah.
What would our catchphrase be? If you can't find it,
we will
grind it.
No. If you can't find it, we will.
That's such a low level.
You've lost it. Yeah. We find it.
When you hear the beep, that's supermarket sweep.
Yeah. Not that. That one.
When you, what is it? We'll find your beeping gold.
Oh, good. We'll find your beeping treasure.
Yeah.
We'll find your beeping lost keys.
Yeah. We'll find that beeping pin in your grandma's beeping hip.
Yeah. Or how about this one? If you've lost something, we'll find it for you.
You're such an idiot. Do you know what I did think the other day?
Yeah.
Traditional songs that people sing. There was some program on telly of someone reminiscing about songs they were sang as a kid.
Mm.
And I can't remember what it was, but what it did bring me on to was the ones your nana used to sing.
Yeah.
And they were so weird.
They were.
We have to have them on the
yeah,
pod.
Yeah, I'll do it now.
Right. Just give a bit of backstory.
So we used to go for a sleepover at my nana and granddad's. We'd get in bed with my nana in the morning and granddad would go and make us a cup of tea. And she'd sing songs to us and that's it.
Yeah, but come on, some of them are weird.
Well, there's only one I can remember,
I can remember them all.
What?
There's more than one.
What?
First, do the codfish.
Okay. I like oysters, lobster too. I like a tasty bit of fish. When I get home from work at night, I get my favorite dish. Fish. Hold tight. Hold tight. Hold tight. Hold tight. Fruity Akasaki wants some seafood. Mama. Codfish and sauce. And then, of course.
Absolute madness.
It's from a film.
Which film?
I found it. Right, are you ready for the... Will we be allowed to play the original?
No.
20 seconds of it.
Well, maybe. Yeah, go on.
Yeah, exactly.
I remember you doing that when you said to me, oh, this is a song my grandma used to sing. And I remember hearing that thinking, she's lost her mind, dear.
Yeah. Are you ready?
Choo-choo to Broadway, Foo, Cincinnati. Don't get
it,
you with one, two,
three. Life is just so fine on the solid side of the line. Flip, hold tight, hold tight, hold tight, hold tight. Rudy acts like he wants some seafood, mama.
Shrimps and rice, they're very nice. Hold tight, hold tight, hold tight, hold tight. Rudy Akasaki wants some seafood, mama. Shrimps and sauce, they're very nice. I like oysters, lobster too. I like a tasty bit of fish. When I get home late at night, I get my favorite dish. Fish, hold tight, hold tight, hold tight, hold tight. Rudy Akasaki wants some seafood, mama.
There you go.
But your nan was freestyling around.
Oh, yeah, I know. But isn't that amazing?
What a weird song
to sing. I know, I love
it.
Andrew's sister.
So she sang some mad stuff.
It was lovely.
Did you like it?
Yeah, I can still smell her.
Your nana?
Yeah.
Nana's had a smell, didn't they?
They did have a smell.
What did she smell of?
I want to say lavender.
Yeah. I always remember her having an... chocolate eclairs in a handbag. Not the actual cake, that would be insane.
Yeah.
But the little sweets.
Yeah. Yeah.
She'd have them in there.
She had a sweet.
Just squirreling away.
Yeah. Yeah.
Unwrapping them, snaffling.
Yeah.
She was a snaffler.
Well, she was really quite mean when my dad was growing up. There were three boys. My dad was the eldest. And
tell that story.
What?
About your Uncle Les.
Oh, yeah. So Uncle Les asked for a rucksack for his school trip. And she says, well, if you have it, you're not having anything for Christmas. And she stuck to it. And he woke up on Christmas morning and he didn't have anything. And he cried and cried and cried.
Sat and watched his brothers. So
my
bro-
no, but they didn't have a lot anyway. They only had one present each. But my dad says he remembers having to give something to Les to make him stop crying. So the two brothers had to kind of rally around and give him something. But she stuck to it.
That is hardcore.
She stuck to it. And she was like...
I mean, you don't enter into a contract with the kid. If you have this now,
yeah.
There's nothing on Christmas yeah. Day. Okay. Because the kid's thinking, you'll never commit
to
that.
My dad said that she was quite mean. And she was... She... I mean, we never saw this side to her. Because they mellow, don't they, as they get older.
They do.
But when she was...
And when it's grandkids, was, yeah, it's once removed, isn't
I think
it?
So.
Yeah.
But...
She was singing songs about fish to you. I mean,
they would never get a full... Like, my dad remembers that if they had a Mars bar, she would split it. You know, they'd never get one each, but she would have her own stash.
That's bad.
And she would have real butter, but they would never be allowed real butter.
Have a real
they'd
butter?
Have margarine.
So she'd have a little butter in the
yeah,
fridge.
Yeah, that she would have for herself.
Little at the back.
Yeah. And she would always take money off him for his paper round.
Didn't she as well when you used to go to your Auntie Joyce's?
Oh, yeah.
And she'd say, Auntie Joyce,
Auntie
would,
Joyce
say,
would always say, come on, lads, have something more.
Don't look at your mum.
Yeah, she'd say, don't look at your mum, because she'd always be saying, you're not having any more. And they'd be like, and she would always like, come on, lads, you can have a bit more. You can have another cake.
Don't look at
don't
your mum.
Don't look at your mum.
I love that. I love how Joyce was the one who thought,
yeah,
I'm going to put the cat amongst the pigeons.
Well, no, she was just so, I'm not... Oh, it's a hard one, isn't it? But Joyce was so generous and kind.
Where does the meanness come from, though?
She was one of 13.
Oh, your nana?
Yeah.
Right.
So that was it.
What do you mean?
Like, when you're one of 13, you don't have anything, do you?
No, you were down the pecking order.
Oh, my God.
I mean, that's like living in a workhouse. That's Oliver Twist she was living through.
Yeah, she was one of 13 children.
13?
Yeah, and one of them's still alive, Elsie, in Manchester. She's the last remaining sibling.
Wow. So she's wandering around now still eating chocolates.
No,
out of
she's
her
96.
Bag.
She ain't wandering around. But she's still got all her faculties.
Yeah. Your nana, when she was around, used to think I was German. She kept calling me Jürgen. Don't you remember?
Yeah, there was a period of time when she called you Jürgen.
She
I
was
don't
like,
know why.
Why did she think I was German?
No, she didn't think you were German. She just thought you looked German.
I have been.
Oh, I know why it was. Because Peggy's family, Peggy across the road, her family were German and he was called Jürgen and he looked like you.
Yeah.
That was it.
Don't he look like Jürgen?
Yeah, that was it. I remember now.
He looks like
it wasn't
Jürgen,
just that she was insane. Yeah, yeah.
It was so funny how they it is a weird how their life sort of you look like we've talked about this before, like my mum and dad are like a dynamic energy. And your nan and granddad around the same age decided to just
well,
watch
no,
telly.
But we've all said that the older generation that went before, you sort of decided you were old and that was it then. You sort of were
old.
You dress a certain way and things have changed, haven't they?
Yeah.
Things have changed.
What, as in you have to be more with it? There's more pressure well, to
no, I don't
stay
think there's any
life.
Pressure. I just think that you can feel like you can be... Well, people are living longer, so they feel more energised and more... I don't know. I don't know what it is.
Do you not think it's weird, though, that I think we are a more... Do you think there's more... The older people now have more energy, as a rule, than they did?
Well, it just depends if you're lucky enough to have your health, I suppose. But if you have got your health, and yeah, you do live longer. And so therefore, you keep going longer, you work longer. I mean, your dad still works. He's 75.
It's mad. My mum and dad live a more active life, I think, than some 30-year-olds.
Probably.
Don't they?
It depends on character as well. Like, your mum and dad are that sort of people, aren't they?
They want to squeeze every minute out of the day.
They do.
So this is that book you got?
This is a book I got for Christmas. It's called The Almanac. What does that make you think of?
Back to the Future.
Yes, I knew you'd say it. It basically gives you month by month what's coming. And I just love stuff like this. First of all, January, the dates. There's so much happening in January. It says, spend time outside during the year and you will soon come to see that there is a season for everything. For seeds so tentatively germinate and begin to grow. for frantic work such as that of the honeybees when the sun shines, for harvesting and feasting and for closing down, resting and recovering. Our human years generally do not cycle. And I thought that was really interesting.
What do you mean by that?
In terms of the fact that, well, it sums it up here. We hit the ground running in early January, let up for a couple of weeks in August when you go on holiday, and then push on through until the Christmas break. And I thought, that is life, isn't it? You don't really have, we don't have cycles in human years. We don't let up ever.
No.
You know, you might give yourself a holiday in August and then you have a bit of a bit of downtime in Christmas and that's it.
Mm.
Unless, and that's what I'm saying, unless we consciously make ourselves take time off and time for ourselves. There's not much, not like animals where you hibernate all winter. And
why do you think humans should hibernate? I think we should.
Well, what this book is saying here is, you know, listen to nature.
Well,
now is time to be slow and to take time and heal and recover.
There is, I do think that when the night gets darker and as it gets colder, you do eat more.
Yeah.
You want to be inside more.
Yeah.
We have still got that within us.
Yeah.
You know, you can't, I mean, we slept for 10 hours last night.
Not really, but yeah.
We did. No, and you're still yawning.
We didn't go to bed till gone midnight, and I got up at 9, so that's not 10 hours, is it?
Well, it's still a decent chunk.
Yeah.
I do think humans should hibernate. I think you should
We can't.
No, but I think you should be able to say to your employee, look, it's my hibernation window now.
Yeah, I'm going to sleep for 3 months.
I've been to Lidl. I'm squirreling away nuts. Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to see you in 3 months.
Just your Asda delivery man turning up at the door every week. But apart from that,
I am hibernating. Not going anywhere. I am not hibernating, mate. I'm squirreling away.
Yeah.
And wake me up when the nights get lighter. Yeah.
And it says here, unlike the birds and the bees, the flowers and the trees, we are forever on. And it's true. We are. But the natural year can act as a guide to living if we let it.
Oh, like these spiritual people who live by the sun.
Well, it's saying January, it just so happens, is a wonderful place to start. Because if you step outside now and look for obvious activity, you will find, well, very little. And it's right. You know, so it's about, and I'm not going to read anymore, but I'm just saying that this book, it's about trying to get you to stop and think about what's going on around you, what's happening in nature. It talks about the moon. It gives you the... it gives you the sunset and sunrise. And it's so nice as you go through the book, you see that shifting earlier and earlier and earlier, obviously, as we get towards summer. And also...
You're like a little wise old sage, you aren't
well,
you?
Well, I find stuff like this interesting. It's nice to be in touch with what's going on around you. And it's also... It was interesting that we've got two sets of friends at the moment who are on the other side of the world. So we've got our friend Mel, who's gone to New Zealand to visit family. And we've got Claire, who's in... She was listening to the pod this morning. She sent a picture. She's in Australia, Perth, to visit family. So they've got sun in Christmas. And it's so weird to see they're experiencing summer at a time when traditionally we feel like we need to cosset ourselves and hide away and be warm and slow and go to bed earlier. And, you know, it's weird, isn't it, that this time of year, so a time of... celebration and also busy, they've got the sunlight to do it.
Yeah.
And it makes you think, actually, would that be quite helpful? You'd feel more energized for Christmas.
What if it were in summer?
Yeah.
I don't know, but it throws out a cock all the meals. All the food-related stuff works when it's cold.
Wouldn't it be weird
you
to
can't have
winter
a,
in
a
July?
Full roast dinner when you're sweating your nuts off?
But they did.
Really?
Yeah, and they have barbecues.
Yeah, but that's a barbecue, isn't it? Mm. I just think that Christmas is you've got all the films of snow.
Yeah.
All
the, well, I said that to Liv. I said
it all works because it's cold.
Kids in Australia and New Zealand, they've still watched all the traditional films that we've watched and they'll always be set in snow, won't they?
I just think it's really weird to watch It's a Wonderful Life in your flip-flops.
Mm.
It just feels like a weird...
I know what you're saying.
I feel like my body clock could be all over the place.
Yeah.
I don't know. I always feel like that. I always feel like... I think Christmas has to be cold.
Yeah.
I don't know. Mm. I don't know. Maybe one year we will do it in a warm climate. I'm not sure.
I don't know.
But you love books like that, don't you?
I love books like this. I love little books that you can take snippets out of and there's little ponderings and... reflective things. And
you're like a little wise old sage.
I'm not. There's nothing wise about me at all. But what I do like is I like to I'm wise.
You like to think you're wise. You're going to be quoting that to me going, do you know that...
Did you know that to enjoy this month, you should be looking at your ornamental hellebores, dogworm stems, willow stems, hazel catkins, seed heads, grasses, sarcococca, witch hazel, crocuses. Oh, don't you just love it when your crocuses started poking through? I love it.
I love it when my crocus pokes through.
When you see...
It just... It always happens first thing in the morning.
But you know, some people do find this time of year a struggle, and I really get that. You know, if Christmas isn't all that, and, you know...
I used to have one of those lamps at work, those sad lamps.
Yeah.
Because I used to find it...
people genuinely...
It doesn't help your yawning through
it. People genuinely need
it. You make
it.
Me tired.
Sorry, but people genuinely need a lift because it is dark and all that. And if you're not part of a big family or you're not, it's not a massively social occasion, Christmas, what is so exciting? And I just want us all to just take a minute now and get excited, right? Get excited about the fact that crocuses will be pushing through.
This is so
incrementally
nerdy.
Every day we're getting lighter. Every day the buds are going to be coming out. We can look forward to warmer mornings, to those spring days, to the flowers, to the trees, the colours coming out, the leaves coming out. That, to me, it fills you with hope. It fills you with... It's so lovely, the cyclical sort of shows the signs that things are moving on.
Look at you.
It's lovely. You love spring. I love spring.
You're such a sad geek.
So to that end.
No, but thing is though.
Happy New Year.
Yeah, but then we've got to go through snow and ice first.
Oh God, what's happening in America?
Minus 50, mate.
I would not be happy.
Do you remember when it was minus 13 that year?
15.
15
went to 15,
here.
2010.
Shitting Jesus.
Do you know?
I was...
We all... Kids,
that was cold.
Kids especially, they really want a white Christmas. They love a bit of snow. But when I saw those images from America, I thought, oh God, I can't think of any... You know, when the snow is so thick and it becomes like... You know, when people think, oh, how can you get, you know, upset about weather? But when it comes to a point where it stops you leaving your home, and what if you haven't got enough supplies at home? What if you can't get somewhere? What if you can't get to the emergency services? It is a crisis.
You won't be thinking about your crocuses popping through then, will you?
Nothing will be popping through.
It's interesting though, isn't it? Because I remember that minus 13.
15.
And we were in Manchester.
Yeah.
Because Liv wasn't very well. And I remember, do you remember just the ice?
It was so bad.
Everywhere. Skating everywhere, wasn't it?
It was so, so cold.
It was...
My mum and dad...
Baltic.
Because we were at Manchester Children's Hospital that Christmas and... my mum and dad brought Christmas dinner to us.
Oh, wow.
And then your mum and dad bought Christmas dinner to us on Boxing Day. And my mum and dad said there was ice on the insides of the car window. It was so
cold.
Well,
our boiler packed up here.
Yeah, it did.
And
your
dad had to come round and get it going again. There was ice on in the house, on the walls.
Awful.
Holy shit balls. And I remember that Christmas when we smuggled in the Christmas dinner. Mm. We were drinking those little bottles of wine in the toilets.
No, we weren't. That's bullshit.
Or smuggling it.
No, we just had it next to our beds.
I remember your mum putting out the buffet in one of those cardboard thick things.
No, she didn't.
She put out some stuffing balls in that because
we
didn't have enough plates.
No, she didn't.
We did.
You're a child lying, aren't you?
I'm lying. Yeah. We had a buffet. We had red wine and
a drip. We were allowed to bring food onto the ward.
We used all the implements of...
and we just had... My mum basically bought it plated up, didn't she?
We had eggnog in syringes.
How did we do it?
Tupperwares.
No, how did we... Did we heat it up in the microwave?
It's all cold.
So we had a cold buffet.
And it was all, we borrowed some of those medical trays and your mum put some stuff on it.
No, we didn't.
We did.
Scott.
We had a buffet on the ward.
We did, but we didn't use any medical stuff.
We used
my mum bought
stuff.
It with her.
We had syringes of eggnog.
Oh, God.
We had
why do you have to make everything so over the top?
I had a commode full of cranberry. we used the facilities around us. We did.
But...
And it was Baltic.
Yeah. Chris, oh, let's not bring the mood down.
What do you mean?
I was just going to say Christmas on a in a hospital is a different thing, isn't it?
I'm sort of, in a way though, I know it was a traumatic time, but I'm sort of glad we did it because it made me appreciate that it isn't that big a deal. It's a great time of year if things are great.
But it's just a day.
But it's not a big deal.
We just let it go, didn't we?
It didn't matter. None of it mattered.
No, because what matters is health.
It was done as quick as it was, you know, the build up and then
it
was done.
And also, what is incredible is how, what does get you through is like the camaraderie in a hospital.
Yeah.
There's a real sense of like, I don't know, you just pull together, don't you?
Mm.
And we're still in touch with a family who are opposite us.
Yeah, we are.
I still message Jude.
Yeah.
And her children are grown up now. And yeah, and I the nurses were so incredible.
Yeah.
Made it so special.
But I'm not glad we saw it, but it was quite a moment. But it was a moment where it made me appreciate that when things are going okay and everything's fine, you've just got to sort of be thankful for that
That's
moment.
That's right.
Because it's a weird place to be. The world, it doesn't matter, does it? The world still continues. None of it. We had to do our Christmas shopping from a pound shop. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
I do.
That's all we could go to. Yeah. It was in Wivenshaw.
It's weird how life stopped, didn't it? We didn't do any Christmas shopping. We didn't write any Christmas cards. We didn't have a tree.
No.
Nothing.
No.
Nothing that year.
Just sat in a ward.
Yeah.
It was weird, wasn't it?
It was weird.
But there we go.
But we came home on the 2nd of January. I remember it.
Yeah.
And we'd not been home for 5 months. And it was weird. It was really weird.
What do you mean?
Coming home.
Yeah.
I felt weird.
Yeah.
I felt a bit scared. Because I'd become institutionalised.
I could still hear the beeps.
Yeah.
On the beep.
The obs.
Beep. On the ward. Mm. We were doing, it was weird, wasn't it? All that sort of time. It seems like another lifetime, doesn't it, that really?
But we did meet Manchester United because they came to the ward.
Shit!
Because I think at Manchester Hospital, Children's Hospital, they often do that at Christmas. There'll be some sort of, I think the Corrie cast have visited quite a lot.
Yeah.
And that year we got to meet Wayne Rooney, Michael Carrick. Who was the other ones? Vladimir Putin. No, what was his name? No, what was his name?
I wish we had met Putin on the tour of the world.
What was his name, Vlad?
Good morning, brothers.
What was that footballer?
Are you sure we should be meeting Vladimir Putin?
There was four footballers. There was Carrick, Rooney.
And I forget the other guy. Yeah.
Come on.
I can't remember the other guy. Yeah.
There was two other players.
Yeah. I know what you mean.
Jamie?
No.
Darren?
No.
No.
Darren?
Yeah. Darren.
One of them went very well. One of them had a colitis.
Oh.
This is a very cheery conversation. But anyway, yeah.
Anyway, four footballers. Rooney.
Rooney.
So tall.
Yeah.
He's so tall.
He's a beast.
I couldn't believe Wayne Rooney was so tall.
Didn't you say to him, "You're so tall, Wayne"? You're like his nana. He came onto the ward.
And the thing is, Liv was only 6 months old, so she had no idea.
Wayne Rooney was meeting us.
Yeah. We were like buzzing. We were like, wow.
You feel like pointing, going, that's the baby.
Yeah.
They don't know who you are.
I got them all.
We're meeting you.
I got all their autographs. We got a photo with them.
What was it?
They gave her a Manchester United bear.
They did, yeah.
Cute.
And what did you say to Wayne?
I didn't say anything.
You said, do your children like Christmas?
Did I?
And he said, they like the lights.
Oh, they love the lights.
They love the lights.
Yeah,
and you went, you're so much taller in real life,
yeah,
Wayne.
He was
and
tall.
Then you said, would you like to come to the pension award? No, I'm not allowed.
You are.
He likes a grandma, didn't he? Apparently.
He likes a grandma?
Yeah, that's the rumour.
Oh,
that
he
went with a grandma,
an older woman. No, he didn't.
It's a truth rumour.
He didn't go with
Google
a grandma.
Google it. She was a grandma, apparently. He likes
an
old lady.
Yeah, but there's a grandma and there's a grandma.
I think she was old.
No.
She was old.
No, she won.
Like the lights.
I like the lights.
I like her, Nana.
No, she...
Come on,
oh,
Nana.
Oh, no.
Come
that's
on.
Horrible.
Apparently, yeah. That's the rumours, mate. But yeah, we met Wayne Rooney, who came on the ward.
Came on the
what
ward.
What a weird Christmas
ward
that
85.
Was. I know.
Yeah.
And then Sophia was in that little... Olivia was in that little frigging car. Used to push it everywhere,
yeah,
all the way down to Costa.
Should we stop reminiscing about this now? It's not even a pleasant memory.
It's not, is it? Why
no,
are we doing it?
I don't know. Oh. But anyway,
yeah,
that's that. You've still not told us your your resolutions for this year.
I don't make them.
Why? Because they'll fail.
Because they fail, or I just it gives me another thing
to stress about.
Stresses about. My resolution
is to not have resolutions.
Is to not have resolutions.
Do you know what? It's not a bad one. That I'm with you.
You know.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think you can.
It's quite a nice resolution to have a spa, though, isn't it? And I think we can all achieve that one.
Yeah, we can go on a spa. Look at you.
Sorry.
Blowing the schnoz. I read recently that Victoria Beckham's had the same meal for 25 years.
What do you mean? Every day?
Yeah.
No.
According to David.
No.
Steamed fish and vegetables. It's pretty much the same meal she's eaten for 25 years. Hmm.
No, I don't believe that.
Well, it's what she's saying. Don't discount the story.
I don't believe it.
Well, it's what I'm reading the story.
Where from? The Sun?
No. Let me just read it. Look.
I don't believe it.
No, listen.
You're telling me she's not been to Wagamama's, I don't know, yakisoba?
David Beckham claims that his wife Victoria has eaten the same meal for 25 years. Isn't it weird how it's totally normal to eat the same breakfast every day, but the thought of having the same dinner 7 days in a row is just bonkers. They've been together for over 20 years. Victoria has been having the same meal for a quarter of a century. I get quite emotional about food and wine. When I'm eating something great, I want everyone to try it, explained. Unfortunately, I'm married to someone who has eaten the same thing for 25 years. Since I met her, she only eats grilled fish, steamed vegetables, and she will rarely deviate from that. So I am not lying, because those are the words from David's face.
But I bet she does have some variety. But unfortunately, there could be some truth to it, because what I'm saying is this celebrity world where they're obsessed with their weight, obviously steamed vegetables and grilled fish is incredibly healthy. And she probably just sees it as a safe way of never putting on weight. But how sad not to have roast potatoes to taste, fried halloumi to taste. Oh, it's making me hungry now. You know, a pop of pizza. Oh, God.
She's never had a pizza, mate.
Oh, it's making me go.
But do you remember? It's an interesting one, is food, don't you think? The weird relationship we
have
with it.
I did say to Chinese Grace, right? So
just to clarify that, what? Grace is definitely Chinese.
Yeah, she's Chinese. She's from Hong Kong. she's Hong Kong. She's Hong Kong Grace.
So yeah, she's not Chinese.
I did say to
Hong Kong Grace.
I said to Hong Kong Grace, would it be okay if she came and lived with me for a couple of months?
Why?
Because...
So you can eat clean.
She eats... Because we were talking about the difference between Western diet and her diet. She prepares every day. She says it takes her quite a long time to prepare the meals. And it's always fresh fish, meats, vegetables. And we were just saying, we were analysing her diet compared to our diet. And I'm not saying we have a bad diet. I think we have quite a balanced diet. But we do eat a lot of shit as well, I think.
Yeah.
And I think snacks are the downfall.
Well, also as well, though, your mum would do a full dinner and a pudding every night.
Yeah.
And that era is not uncommon. Where I used to work with my boss, he used to say that his mum used to do a full apple pie, full roast dinner
but
every
that's fine.
Night.
I think that was okay.
No, but a full apple pies. And
yeah, but that would be the only thing you would eat, Scott. The difference today is that people fill their faces with chocolate bars, crisps, fast food. It's all the shit that goes with it. If you were eating just that as a balanced diet, that's why wartime Britain or post-war Britain, people were eating a vegetable dinner, meat and a pudding, and that was it. That was all you were eating. There wasn't the snacks available like there is today.
It does make you feel better eating clean.
But Grace was saying that her, you know, I said, I reckon if I let her cook for me for 2 months, I would lose weight.
Move her in then.
She can't. She said no.
She said no.
No.
I think it does make you eat clean. That diet is so low in saturated fats.
That's the thing as well. It's the carbs. Like, we have such a variety of carbs, like a lot of bread. And Letty was saying, Coffee Club Letty, that she'd read something, or I can't remember who she's spoken to, but basically they were saying that we should treat bread like cake.
Oh, no. So, I hate this. I hate the devil. I hate the way they demonize bread.
Don't shoot
bread.
The messenger. I'm just saying that bread should be...
Warburton's is the devil.
They were saying that bread... And that day I'd had 6 slices of bread.
That's too much bread.
Why?
Well, yeah,
I'd had toast for breakfast, and I think I'd had toast for lunch, and I think I'd had toast before I went to bed.
You idiot.
6 slices.
That's half a loaf.
With Lurpak and Marmite. Yeah. But look, what we were saying is that that's the difference between Hong Kong Grace's diet and ours. That she's not got the bread, not got the potatoes. It is, she does eat rice with every meal, but rice is so much healthier, isn't it?
Mm. So, well, it breaks down more, doesn't it? I think this is a weird thing that we do this like detox in January. Mm. We splurge ourselves during this month, and then we go, in January, I'm going to not drink, and I'm going to cut back, and I'm going to join a gym. I just think, well, why do that to yourself?
Mm.
Because it's an unsustainable target, isn't it?
Mm.
Do you know what I mean?
I do.
I think January, you need a drink.
Yeah. Mm.
Do you not find that?
I'm not sure.
You know, you need. It's the most miserable month of the year.
Yeah, it's probably... Why don't they do dry November?
Yeah, on the run-up.
Yeah, detox before, then have a good splurge out.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I think...
Everything in moderation.
I do genuinely feel better if I've eaten stuff that's all been fresh from the ground up. Do you know what I mean?
I do.
I do find, like, you if you have too much bread, you feel stodgy.
Mm.
So you've got to see if bread is his cake. Bread is now cake.
Well, this is what they're saying.
But if you actually think
about it... But I can't abide by that because I love bread. I love bread.
What's the default option then if you're not having bread at lunch? You have to make something. It becomes a ball ache.
Well, I'm sorry, but you've just summed it up there. You can't be arsed, can you?
No.
Well, you need to be arsed.
Well, what are you making? If not, then you've got to go.
Salad.
Oh, I don't want to chop a salad.
Have a boiled egg.
Oh, boiled egg. I hate
Have a boiled egg with some tuna and some salad. Or have some rice with some vegetables.
For dinner?
Yeah.
Then I've cooked. No, you don't even like me making a mess of the cooker.
What, you don't have to make a mess of the cooker?
I do.
No, you don't.
When I cook, it's a mess.
Scott, that could be your new resolution.
What?
Just be less messy.
I find it hard. It spits. Pans spit, don't they?
Yeah, wipe after.
I do wipe. But just it's wipe. It's never to your standard.
This is annoying.
Anyway, I've got a resolution for you.
Go on.
Never lend anything of ours to anyone.
Right. Right, can I just explain to the listener? We had a couple of stresses before the podcast this morning. I was accused of moving his computer cable. Where was it?
In a drawer.
Why did you put it there?
Because we were watching a DVD and I connected it to the telly.
Right, so that wasn't my fault, but he swore to God I'd moved it.
Because sometimes...
And he gave me 10 rounds about
no,
it.
No, sometimes you do a Gemma move, which no, is where you move something no. and you don't remember where you've moved it.
Right, second of all, what did you get angry about?
Last night, we were settling down. Mm-hmm. We wanted to watch Scrooged.
And he's claiming I've lent it to someone that I have absolutely no recollection of.
I remember the conversation where you said to someone...
He can remember a conversation, but he can't remember who it was with, said, which is very unhelpful.
You need to watch this film with Bill Murray. It's absolutely wonderful. And as it went across the threshold out of our house, in my head, I thought...
I don't remember this.
This should not be happening. You're breaking the rules. Never
so
lend.
So basically, he then gave never a big speech lend. To Liv saying, don't ever lend anything to anyone. And I said, that's a miserable existence. You can lend to people. Be kind always. And Scott said, don't be kind. Don't lend anything ever.
I think if you lend DVDs or books, you stand a chance of never getting them back.
I just think that's a sad way to live. But anyway, I rebuke the accusation that I've lent this because I don't remember lending it to anyone. I don't know where it is. It'll be somewhere.
What else have I done that's annoyed you then? Get it off your chest.
And the last one was that he would not allow me to record the podcast wearing my pyjamas.
Because I think it's just a little bit... We have to make it some sort of professionalism.
No, you don't. You look a tramp. You're only wearing a T-shirt. And what's the difference between this jumper and the jumper I was wearing
it's
before?
It's the mindset of being in the pyjamas.
I'm not having it. So he got very upset about the fact I was going to do the podcast.
I didn't get very upset.
I just say, I wasn't wearing like Bert and Ernie pyjamas. I was wearing a jumpsuit. So it was a velour jumper with velour trousers. I don't see how that is going to impede my ability to record a podcast.
If I'd have done the podcast wearing my dressing gown with my knackers swinging.
Your knackers won't be swinging.
It brings a different
energy.
There's
no swing.
They aren't swanging yet. to know that there's one piece of cloth separating my genitals from the world is not the energy I want to bring to the podcast.
But that's not the same as a velour jumpsuit. I don't see how that would have been a problem. And also, I think it's, you know, our promotional photographs for this podcast are wearing our dressing gowns. I mean, it's the morning. Mm. I don't see how it would have been a problem.
Would you ever go to the shops in your pyjamas?
I fed the cats yesterday in my pyjamas.
You went round?
Yeah.
In your pyjamas? Yeah. Would you ever go to the shop in your pyjamas in your dressing gown?
No.
I saw someone do it the other day. It's so weird, isn't it?
I've never seen anyone doing that.
I have.
I know, but that's very rare.
Yeah.
Most people wouldn't, would they?
Would you ever do it?
No. No, I wouldn't.
Do you think it's unacceptable?
I don't think it's unacceptable, but, you know, get dressed.
It's the basics, isn't it?
Yeah.
If you're wandering around.
Just get dressed. That's fine. Get dressed. But recording your podcast, I think a velour tracksuit's fine.
Whatever you're getting up to today, guys, I hope you're having a good day.
Yeah.
Happy New Year. Thank you for all the support. I'm going to be on tour again in the new year. I'm going to be releasing some stuff, some ticket sales. I can't speak. I don't know what I'm saying. I'm going to be releasing tickets on sale shortly.
Very good.
For some new dates. I'm also, do you think my voice sounds like it's getting better?
Yeah.
I've been really trying.
Yeah, it's fine.
I've been really trying. I've been drinking water. Yeah. I've been staving off the alcohol.
Yeah, you've done well.
I don't know why it got so bad.
Because you've had a virus.
I hate that virus.
I hate you saying to me, why have I got a voice that's going? And I have to repeatedly say to you, because you've had a virus.
I want you to be able to talk to the virus and say, I want you to be able to have a direct line to that virus.
Mm.
I think genuinely you can help me, but you can't, can you?
No, I can't. There's no helping you, love.
I just have to let it pass.
Yeah, let it go. Anyway, on that bombshell.
It's not our catchphrase. You can't
don't
keep
matter.
Doing that.
Look, loads of people have used that catchphrase.
No, they haven't.
Okay. I'm going to change it then.
Change it.
On that cup of tea.
Jesus.
Have a lovely, lovely day. And we will speak to you next week.
Yeah, see you next week, guys. Have
see
a great
you next
day.
Week. Bye bye.
Grab a copper and stop that yawning. It's time to tune in. It's Sunday morning.